All right, a very good morning and welcome to Focal Point this beautiful Saturday morning. My name is Victoria Namtebi Luaga. And tonight we are talking Uganda-China relations. How good is this relationship? How healthy is it to Uganda as a nation? Well, to discuss this, I'm joined by Ambassador Henry Mayiga, the Deputy Head of Mission. Welcome to the show, Ambassador.
Thank you very much for the opportunity afforded to me.
Yeah, good to have you here.
Thank you.
Now, we'll start off with China and its economy, well-developed economy, and huge funding to Africa. And we're saying, okay, Uganda inclusive among the African countries, and the extent of taking over some of the huge investments in these countries, how healthy is that move? Most especially when it comes to African countries paying back.
Well, very interesting because, of course, Uganda, once it got independence in 1962, it took this country 7 days to establish an embassy, Uganda embassy in Beijing, in China. And that relationship between Uganda and China has been growing over the years by leaps and bounds. And I'm not surprised that we are where we are. At the moment, in terms of relationship between Uganda and China, it has been building for the last 50 years. But where are we? And that's a very important question. Where are we and what does that mean in terms of paying back the loans? Of course, that has been a concern by many. Money is flowing into Uganda, not only Uganda, but also in the rest of the African countries, because only recently we had the Fokaka Summit in Beijing in the first week of September 2018, which was attended by President Yoweri Museveni, and still more funding is coming. And so I think people's concern about that funding is not misplaced, because there are always questions. But I want to say, and to comfort Ugandans, that the funding from China is slightly different from the other sources where we've been getting funding and support, because it has less strings attached.
Right.
Yes, we have to pay back the loans, and I believe that the government is doing a very good job to put it to use the money given to us by China most efficiently and effectively. Because only recently, as you have been seeing, there are quite a number of projects that the president has been opening over the past, should I say, 3 weeks,
yes,
or a month or two, or something like that. Project after project, project after project, funded apart from the bridge, which was, of course, funded by the Japanese. But these loans, in my view, or the monies, or the grants, and the support, really, because there is real support that is coming from China, is being put to better use. And I think this country is going to be in a position to pay back these loans, because once these monies come into our economy, they budget it, they expand it, they make it more efficient to the extent that we are going to have capacity to pay back the loans in good time.
Oh, wow. I like so that.
Absolutely.
Investments actually will help us get the money that will pay them
absolutely
back.
Absolutely.
Okay, quite
because there's always a return on investment. Yeah, yeah.
So Uganda is safe.
Absolutely.
All right. So we really appreciate the projects that China has done. The recent, the Sukulu project, that has the organic fertilizer's biggest, at least in East Africa.
Absolutely.
And I'm thinking, okay, what more should we expect from the Chinese government? Like, are there any other projects that are in the pipeline that we've not yet known of?
Of course, the concern is about loans, but there are also grants,
okay,
over which we don't have to pay an interest, we don't have to repay them. And there is one of the agreements which was signed between the government of Uganda and the government of China was actually to give us assistance in terms of food support. And that too is coming, and it's free. There's no repayment of that money, and so on and so forth. The president was there when this agreement was being signed between the officials from the government of China and also the officials from the government of Uganda. So there is that support. But there is also support which is extended to peace and security. Our operations in Southern Sudan, our operations in Somalia, and then the rest of these places, and so on and so forth. There is that support which is also forthcoming. But there is also support for infrastructure, because if we don't categorize this support coming from China, then we will not understand the full extent of how this support is actually going to help us in terms of economic growth. So there is all sorts of support in terms of infrastructure, in terms of peace and security, in terms of food aid, in terms of of course, support for trade, because there is now even support for trade. How do we promote trade between Uganda and China? For the benefit of probably our listeners, the volume of trade between Uganda and China is about 800, or call it a billion US dollars. Okay. Or, to be specific, slightly over 800 million US dollars. Mm. Out of that, the goods and services that we sell to China account for only about, currently, about 30 million US dollars. So, but there is now support, which is going to come from China, to support and increase exports, Ugandan exports to China. Wow. For me, that is very fundamental because the trade has been really unbalanced. It hasn't been balancing out between the two countries. Mm. So when that support comes, and it's going to be extended to the rest of the African countries, Uganda inclusive, how do we support, for instance, the fruits sector in this country? Because when a Chinese eats a pineapple from Uganda, he will never want to eat a pineapple from any other place or country. Oh. And so how do we support these exports, especially agricultural exports, because Uganda, you know, is an agricultural economy, so that we can export much more of these products. And that means, of course, earning an income as a country. Mm. And so there is that support which is forthcoming, which is going to come from China to support these exports. And so all sorts of areas are going to benefit from the 60 billion, which the US dollars, which the Chinese offered Africa. And I believe because the government has already put in place a structure, a cross-ministry or cross-departmental structure that's supposed to work out the priority areas where this Chinese support is going to be focused. And so Uganda is going to benefit, I have no doubt in my mind. Uganda is going to benefit from the support from China.
Okay. Yeah. So when should we expect these projects to come?
Well, now, the boundary, of course, between the ongoing projects and the new project is blurred. It's not clear. But it's going to become clearer as time passes. Because, as I've said, there is a structure now which is being supervised by the Prime Minister's office to make sure that the priority areas are defined and refined and also submitted to the Chinese side. And I believe that that is going to be like a shopping list, which we've done before, even with the first 60 billion which was offered by Africa. I mean by China to Africa in 2015, December, because there was another FOCAC summit in Johannesburg in that year. And there is so much that has gone under the bridge. I mean the Karuma Bridge, I mean the Karuma Dam, the Isimba Dam, and quite a number of other projects. Of course, you don't want me to mention the President's office, the new tower, and the Prime Minister's tower, and the Foreign Affairs Ministry. Over the years, these things have been happening, and as a result of the support we are receiving from China. So I believe, like they say in management, there is a concept called incrementalism, that already there has been that support from China. And we are going to add on much more in the subsequent 3 years. The support that is going to come from China is going to really increase the benefits that we are getting. I mean, the benefits we are getting from the support from China
as a country.
As a country.
Okay. Yeah. So, how should the common man position themselves to benefit from this also?
Common man, common woman.
Okay, yeah, the
common person
down there at the grassroots.
Fantastic, fantastic. Because I have only mentioned the things to do with the economy, but there are other things that support the economy. For instance, like institution to institution collaboration, like university to university collaboration, like cooperation between the UPDF and the government of China or the army in China, like, and so many of these things, which are also going to attract a lot of support from the Chinese. Recently, the reason why I initially came, apart from losing my late brother, from Attorney General, was because I was bringing a group of Chinese officials from the best China, the best Chinese university, which is called Tsinghua University. And that university is in the process of establishing a collaboration between Makerere University and also UCU, Uganda Christian University, Mukono, with itself. And I believe that there's going, because they've signed the memorandums of understanding, and some of the areas which have been identified for cooperation include staff exchanges, student exchanges, joint researches, establishment of a laboratory for public safety. That is a new area in terms of academics. I never thought that academics would would pick interest in public safety, but this is a matter of security. It's a matter of stability. It's a matter of peace and security. It's extremely important. So that university is going to collaborate with the Makerere University. It's going to collaborate with the Uganda Christian University. It is also going to work with KCCA in terms of traffic control.
Oh, wow.
Ugandans have a problem, especially in the urban areas, of traffic. How do you control traffic? I mean, I tried when I came for the morning show this morning, I mean, earlier today, As I was driving back to Kampala, it took me about 30 minutes to reach the city center. As a result of, so
traffic.
That Tsinghua University has got a department, an institute, that has worked out a technology which is being used in many urban areas in China, including in Beijing, where we are based as an embassy of Uganda,
okay.
that helps to control traffic. Mm. And so that technology is in the process, if all works out well, is going to be used by KCC in terms of traffic control and all these kinds of things. Mm. So there are so many other things that are not necessarily to do, have no direct relationship with the economy, but in a sense, they support the economy, like university-to-university collaboration, like army-to-army collaboration, like police collaborating with the university, and so on and so forth.
Mm.
And all these things, in my view, are very good for Uganda.
Okay. Yeah. You talked about the agricultural development, and you're thinking, okay, so should the man up those ends in maybe up country, should they go dig and prepare themselves? Will they be among those that will be chosen as exports? How will government come in to make sure that our exports meet the quality that our vegetables or fruits meet the quality that China would like to take as exports?
Oh, you're talking about the common person.
Yes.
Absolutely. Yes. You're right. Because when, for instance, already there's a lot of technical teams are on ground to advise on how to increase agricultural production in the country. These things are not in the public domain, but many Chinese technical people are already on the ground to advise on how to increase agricultural production.
Mm.
And that assistance is going to be increased. It is mentioned in the action plan that was adopted at the FOCAC summit in the first week of September, and it was signed by all the countries, including, of course, China, which was the host.
Mm.
And I believe that that technical assistance, which is coming our way as a country, to increase, to support and increase the technical expertise, which I'm talking about, to try and support and increase agricultural production, will definitely benefit the common person.
Mm.
Yeah.
They're doing about universities. You talked about the different projects. And I was just wondering, are there some sponsorships that we will benefit from, or the people at the university?
Absolutely.
Okay.
I don't have the figures at the moment, but China has been offering a lot of scholarships to Uganda, which of course goes through the channel those scholarships through their embassy here in collaboration with the Ministry of Education of Uganda.
Mm.
And so many Ugandans have been benefiting from those scholarships. I don't have the figures at the moment, but quite a number of scholarships are coming our way already as a result of that collaboration between that relationship between China and Uganda.
Mm.
And in many areas, just only, I think yesterday, it was even put in the public domain in one of the local newspapers here, of how Makerere University, of course, it has the Confucius Institute, which is already collaborating with the Makerere University and stationed at Makerere University. But there are many Ugandans that are benefiting from the scholarships that are offered by China.
Okay.
We estimate that the numbers of students, Ugandan students studying at the moment in China, are about 800, out of which a majority are private.
Mm.
But there are quite a number of them that have benefited from the Chinese scholarships. So, and that those scholarships are also mentioned in the action plan.
Mm.
Yeah.
So with all these developments in place, do we see the unemployment problem being tackled in Uganda?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I have no doubt in my mind, because, for instance, when the technical expertise is given to us to increase agricultural production, and given the fact that our country is majorly an agricultural one, that increases employment for the common person you're talking about in the villages, so that they can engage in agricultural production and then sell their produce.
Mm.
That supplies a level of employment, actually a big one, given the fact that, of course, the agricultural sector is the biggest in the country.
Okay.
So that way, of course, employment is supplied through that support. But also the other direct support, I mean, for instance, when the factory, phosphate factory in Tororo, which was constructed, is going to offer, I think, quite a number of, they talked about, I think, 3,000 employees that are going to be employed by that factory. So employment, when these projects come, is naturally going to increase, and we'll see less and less of employment in this country.
Okay.
Yeah. Of course, given given the rest of the support that we receive.
Okay, then I'm thinking, okay, won't then the Chinese penetrate us too much to the point of we might lack our independence as a country and we have to depend on them for everything?
As I said before, that the Chinese assistance is totally different from the support that we've been getting from the other countries, of, to be specific, from the Western world. Because it has less strings attached to it, they're not going, for instance, to come here and say that if we must give you aid, then you must be doing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 in terms of politics, in terms of all sorts of things. They don't say that. They give the assistance, and the assistance in terms of funding, for instance, does not have the strings the way we know them from the other sources of funding. So I believe that the Chinese are not up to, of course, they've been accused by many our experts who, in my view, think that they know it all. Therefore, they make all sorts of comments against what the Chinese are doing in Africa. So, well, they, of course, that is their right. They can say it. Of course, there is also a conspiracy theory, which has been talked about by many people, coming from our traditional funders, that the Chinese are trying to take over Africa because they are putting all sorts of monies in there.
Yeah, because,
and in the process, the African continent is going to find itself actually ensconced in a situation where they can't get out. But that's not true, because Chinese assistance, in fact, they will not even give you money. If you are overburdened by debt, they will not give you money.
Okay, they that's a good one.
Yes.
Because I would, someone out there would be thinking, okay, what exactly is the interest of Chinese in African countries? If they're going to come and do all this for us with less strings attached, what are they looking at in the long term? What
no,
are they
looking for? You know, the Chinese philosophy, diplomatic philosophy, is different from the rest of the world, the way we know it. I mean, we are a former British colony, and the diplomacy we've been seeing over the years, over the decades, is really different from the Chinese diplomacy. Diplomacy in China does not believe in sucking you dry.
Oh.
They don't believe in that. They don't believe in that. They believe in assisting others so that they can be uplifted in terms of welfare, in terms of course of economics and all these kinds of things. That is the difference which I see between the Chinese and the rest of the world, which has been supporting us in all sorts of ways. And so they are not going to come to you and then dictate to you all sorts of things that you must, we must give you money, you must do ABCD and so on and so forth. And besides that, the comfort we derive from the support from China is that if you are overburdened by debt, then there is a ceiling beyond which they will go. They will not go in terms of funding your country. I'll give you an example. Just because of this gear, this standard gauge railway, Kenya has done its railway from Mombasa to Nairobi initially, and then from Mombasa to Naivasha, and they're going to do it up to Kisumu, and all this money is borrowed from the Chinese. Now, from Kisumu, because you know we are supposed, there is supposed to be connectivity between Kenya and Uganda, and then in the rest of the region, it's including Rwanda and so on and so forth. But it means that if the Kenyans must do the standard gauge railway from Kisumu up to Malaba, then they must borrow again. But already the Kenyan economy has overborrowed. So the Chinese said,
and the Chinese have a ceiling.
Absolutely, they have a ceiling. So they are saying that they are not going to give Kenya any more money because they have reached the bar. Because they don't want to overburden you. But most importantly, recently China forgave many African countries of their debts.
Oh.
I hope that is in the public domain. If it's not, then I'm mentioning it here.
Mm.
That some countries, the debt burden
was
had actually skyrocketed.
Just like that?
It had skyrocketed, and the Chinese said, no, I think some countries are going to benefit. And at the summit, the FOCACA summit, which was held in the first week of September, it was announced by the president of China that some countries are still going to benefit. They've done it before. They're now doing it again in this new round of funding. That countries, that especially landlocked countries, and I must repeat that because it's written in black and white, landlocked countries that
where
are
Uganda
overburdened.
Falls.
I don't know whether Uganda is one of is going to
a
be one of the beneficiaries,
country.
Because in terms of debt, indebtedness, we're not doing so badly. But it's a landlocked country.
Yeah,
fine,
landlocked
that's okay,
country.
And we're yet to find out whether we are benefiting from that one. I can't say so.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you are still telling us about that the Chinese president, the president of China, was saying that all landlocked countries
are going, landlocked countries in Africa are going to benefit from debt relief.
Oh,
yeah, that was the announcement which he made.
All right, quite interesting. Now let's talk about the political environment, the situation in Uganda. Most of the investors actually get scared when the political. When there's some political instability of sorts, and I'm thinking, okay, don't these Chinese get scared, afraid of the truth?
I think we are overplaying the political stability, or is it instability in Uganda? Because take the case of the U.S. yesterday, for instance, you remember those Paso bombs?
Yes.
That were said, if that was to happen in Uganda, then people would hype that idea that probably that's going to scare investors here. But the political volatility is not an exclusive problem of Uganda. It's a problem worldwide. That any time you may get these threats and all these kinds of things. Unless you become a failed state, which I believe Uganda is not. We are a state which is very strong in terms of politics, in terms of economics, in terms of freedoms of people. Unless you, of course, cross the red lines, they're going to arrest you. There's no doubt about
which happens in every country.
Which happens in every country. So I believe that the stability that this country is enjoying cannot really give an impression to an investor that Uganda is a no-go area. Because many people, especially Chinese, are coming to invest their money. As I speak now, there is a group which had come to see the Minister of Energy over their interest in investing in byproducts from the oil, like, for instance, Vaseline, like fertilizers. I didn't know that, for instance, oil, actually, one of the byproducts are actually fertilizers. I didn't know that. And so that group, so we continuously see a constant stream of people from China who are interested in coming to invest in Uganda. And I want also to appeal probably to the media that the more you talk about the instability, actually you become this very scarecrow that is going to stop investors have picking an interest in investing in Uganda. When actually the situation is not out of hand, because I believe that the situation in this country is not out of hand because there are
still under control.
All sorts of ingredients that show that this is a very good investment destination.
All right. Well, the China-Uganda relations topic is still continuing, but for now we take a short break and return with Ambassador Henry Mayiga telling us more about the relationship between China and Uganda. Stay tuned to Urban TV.